And good morning, everybody. Time for another edition of Tropics Talk. Plenty to talk about. Let's get right to it. We begin with the wide view across the Atlantic. Still, again, there's two areas in the eastern Atlantic that have yet to develop. The Hurricane Center now saying the one in the central Atlantic has a medium chance for development. The one in the sort of southeastern Atlantic has a high chance to develop. Both of them are not going to impact any land areas, even as one or both could grab a name off the list this weekend. So that's the last we'll talk about them here. We'll be watching, but no impact to land areas, certainly not the United States. Certainly not Southwest Florida. But the one, of course, that we're focusing our attention most closely on, Tropical Storm Ida. Here's the 8 a.m. advisory, and finding the storm much stronger already. 5 a.m. came in at 45 miles per hour, now up to a 60 mile per hour tropical storm, moving to the northwest at 15 miles per hour. Center of Ida, right about there. Now, we are seeing the thunderstorm activity collapsing slightly. You tend to see that. Overnight, the thunderstorms flare as the atmosphere, as you go up, cools off a little bit, but the warm waters of, in this case, the Caribbean Sea stay warm, so you tend to see the thunderstorm activity be a little more intense overnight and then collapse a bit once the sun comes up. Still holding strong overall, though, and as we've been telling you, intensification, really the only way for this to go going forward. When you look at a tropical system, what you look for it to strengthen, warm waters, tropical moisture, low wind shear. All three very much lining up for Ida as it moves across the Gulf of Mexico. Now, yes, the storm is going to, in all likelihood, cross the western end of Cuba. You know, a lot of times when we have our storms going across Cuba, Hispaniola, Puerto Rico, we talk about high elevations here. That's a fairly flat portion of Cuba, so it's not going to do much to weaken it, keeping it holding serve perhaps in the near term, keeping it from becoming a hurricane today. But once it gets to the Gulf of Mexico, gets away from land, look at these water temperatures in the mid to low 80s. And these are sea surface temperatures, but as you go way down, the warm water extends deep. So there's deep warm water ahead of this. Lots of heat content in the Gulf of Mexico for this to use as fuel, jet fuel, really. And that is going to give it every opportunity to strengthen. Further, the two other ingredients we talked about, tropical moisture. Yeah, no indication that there'll be dry air to get in the way of Ida as it moves into the Gulf. This is our moisture tracker showing you precipitable water going into Saturday afternoon. Deep envelope of tropical moisture surrounding the storm by the time we get to the afternoon. And then as far as wind shear is concerned, right now there is some wind shear at play helping to weaken it a little bit. Upper level low across the eastern side of the Caribbean, sort of on the fringes of that, between that and the upper low that moved across Florida yesterday, still a little bit of wind shear out of the south and southwest, keeping the storms mainly stacked on the eastern side of Ida right now. But once it gets into the Gulf, that wind shear dies down. It will be able to vertically stack itself. The low-level center going to be stacked up right below the middle, upper-level centers, and that's how these tropical storms, these hurricanes, become those perfect heat engines that take in the warm water from the ocean at the surface, bring it up, and then vent it out up top. And again, everything you look at does show intensification, perhaps rapid intensification in the next 24 to 48 hours over the Gulf of Mexico. Model plots here, each line a different model forecast. Just about every one shows Ida becoming a hurricane. Many pushing into major hurricane territory, and you have to remember, as far as our ability to forecast hurricanes go, we're the models anyway, very, very good at depicting track forecasts, exactly where the center of a developing storm is going to track. Still lagging behind in intensity in particular, models struggle to pick up that rapid intensification process. Think back a couple weeks ago as Grace rapidly intensified, moving towards the coast of Mexico, you know, barely anything showed that, but the conditions were there. History would tell you it was likely to happen. This is the same case here. And when you're already seeing models this far out pushing to Cat 3 intensity, it's a sign, watch out. In all likelihood, this is going to be an intense hurricane headed towards the coast. Now, before we get to the track forecast, I know many of you watching from Southwest Florida, anytime we have a hurricane anywhere near the area, the narrative often goes, you know, Charlie made that hard right turn, so couldn't this make the hard right turn as well? Come for us here in Southwest Florida? No. Direct impacts from Ida, not expected. If you're just playing the latitude game, Ida is basically at the same latitude, or the same longitude as Fort Myers, rather, at this point in time. And it's headed further to the west. High pressure, digging down across Florida. This would have to make a hard turn to the east, and it's just not in the cards. It's not going to happen. We're not going to see a direct impact here in southwest Florida. Just fringe impacts as we're in that moisture field, and it does keep our rain chances up. Every model you look at, really very good model agreement at this point, that New Orleans is, or not New Orleans specifically, but Louisiana is the most likely destination. New Orleans on my mind, as you know, a track like this, hard to imagine a track that would be more of a worst case scenario for New Orleans. Now, there's still wiggle room. This could come further to the east, go more into Mississippi. A good many models I look at showing this going more to the west, western Louisiana, perhaps even as far west as Texas. That's why the Hurricane Center puts their forecast, their track forecast, out as the cone, because you know as you go further out in time, the uncertainty increases, and again, there still is wiggle room. But a path over or to the west of the New Orleans area would, of course, bring them into the right front quadrant of the storm, which is not where you want to be. It's where we'd have onshore winds for hours on end that would maximize the storm surge threat in an area we all know is prone to storm surge flooding. So I don't want to undercut this. This is quite a threat to the northern Gulf Coast here this weekend, in particular Louisiana. Yes, in particular New Orleans. There's the cone of concern. The Hurricane Center has this strengthening to a hurricane by tomorrow afternoon, nearly due west of southwest Florida. Landfall by sometime late Sunday afternoon in the eastern parishes of Louisiana. Again, still wiggle room. The cone of concern tells you. By the time we get to Sunday at 2 o'clock, the center could be anywhere from east of Louisiana and all the way to the western end of the state. But in all likelihood, Louisiana is the final destination, certainly what the models are lining up for at this point. Moving onshore, Category 2 still by 2 a.m. on Monday, and then tracking further inland from there. And no way around it. This is just about as high of a threat as you ever see from a hurricane. Flooding rainfall, yes. Damaging winds, catastrophic wind damage. If this comes onshore as a major hurricane, that would be likely. And storm surge. Major storm surge threat. These are very low-lying areas in the eastern parishes of Louisiana, and in particular, New Orleans. If this is to track just to the west of the city, onshore winds for hours on end, that is going to bring some significant storm surge. If there's one perhaps somewhat silver lining to all this, moves a little quickly, weakens quickly. I'm not seeing a huge signal in the models for a large inland flooding threat, but I do think it's still going to spread a good 4 to 8 inches of rainfall up the lower Mississippi Valley. It is likely to cause at least some inland flooding as well. So we'll be watching Ida closely. Again, no direct impacts here in southwest Florida, but those in the cone, those especially along the coast of Louisiana, coastal Mississippi, perhaps even Alabama, perhaps even eastern Texas, should be preparing for the potential of a major hurricane here this weekend. We'll have updates for you all weekend long. Tonight, Chief Meteorologist John Patrick, he'll have the latest on Ida from the Hurricane Center at 6, 7, and 11. Till next time, meteorologist Jim Dickey, stay safe out there.